Okay, it's time to begin our evening service. If you're visiting with us, thank you. You're an honored guest. We hope you come back to see us again. And also take the time to fill out a visitor's card. And you can leave it in the pew if you like. And if you have a cell phone, could you silence that so don't become a distraction during service. Far as sick or in the hospital, see our bulletin. We got a list of shut-ins and those with ongoing health issues. We have 27 listed there who need our prayers. And Dale Clark, Larry and Katie's brother, is having his second back surgery October 19th in Atlanta. Danny Brown is having hip replacement surgery on October 18th. Teresa Tatum is seeing three specialists this week and requests our prayers to see if she can find some relief. And Shane Shirley is having more tests with a new neurologist this week and is going to Emory in Atlanta for further evaluation. Madeline McNabb needs our prayers for health issues. And we are currently collecting food and supplies for the Tennessee Children's Home. There's a list in the foyer of the needed items. Please place these in the fellowship hall for pickup on November 8th. And our first prayer tonight will be Tony Paris. Closing prayer will be Rodney Jones. And scripture reading will be Micah Perry. And Bob Garrett will be leading us in song.
Scripture reading tonight will be from the book of Matthew. The book of Matthew, chapter 22. Chapter 22, starting with verse 34. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him, and saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets."
Good evening, everyone. Let's start with good old number 300. Number 300.
Walking alone at even, viewing the skies afar, in the darkness come to welcoming silver star. I have a great delight in the wonderful scenes above. God is power and might is showing his truth and love. All for a home with God, a blessedness
pray. Heavenly Father, it is indeed a privilege to bow before you again this day, Heavenly Father, to offer our prayer of thanks for the blessings of this life, the blessings of this building, and the place we have to come to worship thee. Father, we pray that you'll continue to bless each and every family represented here today and those who may be watching. Father, we pray for our sick. We pray that you'll be with Dale Clark and his surgery, Father, with Danny Brown and his surgery, with Teresa Tatum and their testing, and Shane Shirley with his test as well. And be with Sister Madeline McNabb, Father, as she undergoes things to make her better. We pray, Father, that your will be done in all these cases and that they might be restored to their much-wanted health. Father, we pray that you'll continue to watch over the congregation here to help us not only grow in number but in knowledge of your word. And that, Father, our light will be of such that we're able to help those around about us to see your good will. And, Father, we pray that your message will ring loud in those around about us and throughout this community and throughout the world with your missionaries. And, Father, we pray you be with the churches throughout the world, that they be mindful of thee at this day and serving thee as only they can. Father, we ask now that you open our hearts and minds to the things of this hour, that we'll apply them to our daily lives and to help those around about us. Forgive us of our sins. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
If you want to mark 170, that'll be our song of encouragement after the lesson. 170. And then before our lesson, number 42. 42.
Number 42. Encamped along the hills of white, three Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foe in hell's below, let all our strength be heard. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world.
Tonight we're studying once again in the book of Colossians. So if you have a Bible there with you or one on the pew, and grab it. Colossians chapter 3. And for anybody that's keeping count, this is our eighth lesson in this series. Plan is to have 10 lessons. So we're going to start tonight in chapter 3 in verse 18. And then it's not breaking a rule, okay? We're going to go over tonight into chapter 4. And verse 1, because it's pretty clear that the thoughts of chapter 4 and verse 1 go with the tail end of chapter 3. Now, last week in our study, we talked about the idea of putting on the new man. As a follower of Jesus, what are some characteristics that the Lord wants to see in us? Previously, we'd studied in chapter 3, we put off the old man. What are some things that God wants us to keep out of our lives? Well, tonight we're looking at an aspect of life that deals with how we interact with other people. Part of serving the Lord is how we deal with, treat, and interact with others. And tonight we're going to be looking at family relations as well as a unique social relationship. It's a pretty simple text. It's pretty straightforward. Let's start in chapter 3 and verse 18. And again, I'm going to read down through chapter 4 and verse number 1. Chapter 3, verse 18. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Verse 22, servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. And whatsoever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. Chapter 4, verse 1. Masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that ye also have a master in heaven. That's a pretty clear break in the theme, and so that's where we're going to stop tonight. And so tonight we're going to look at instructions that are given to specific groups of people. The Bible is for all mankind. The Bible is God's word for all mankind. But within the instructions that are in the Bible, in different places, we read instructions that are for specific people. For instance, there are some New Testament passages that give instruction to the bishops or the elders of the church. Now, all of us can learn from that, and all of us can appreciate that, and all of us can uphold that and teach it to others, but those instructions apply specifically to elders. And so tonight, we're going to be looking at some brief instruction for wives and husbands and dads and children and servants and masters. Over 40 years ago, somehow we made contact with a brother in the Lord in the area where we were assembling and working, and we began to carry him and his, I think, two children to services. And one day I preached on parenting, and one aspect of the lesson dealt with discipline. And we got in the car and he says, "Oh, Brother Roger," he said, "I really like those verses on discipline. Could you give them to me again?" Let me ask you tonight, which of those verses that we just read together from chapter 3 and verse 18 to chapter 4 and verse 1, which of those verses did you really like? Shouldn't our attitude be the same toward everything that God has to say? We should really like everything that God has to say. Now, I'm going to try my best to avoid a temptation to do something tonight, okay? What we've got, for example, in verse 18, the instructions for wives, that's a little itty-bitty instruction. The temptation is, let's go all over the Bible from Genesis 2 to the end of Revelation, and let's talk about everything the Bible says about wives. Or when we get to children, let's talk about everything the Bible says about children. I'm going to do my best tonight not to make you think that you heard me give six sermons on six topics. I want to deal specifically with what this text says. Now, we may go over to some other verses and grab a couple of ideas, but we're going to try to deal with what the text says right here. And so what the Bible says, what God says through Paul to the church in Colossae, what he says about family relationships, those were needful for the families in Colossae. These are foundational points to make those families as strong as they could be. Not a thing in the world wrong with a human being putting into writing or delivering a message on a podcast or on YouTube. Not a thing in the world wrong with a human being expressing what they consider to be some helps, some suggestions, advice for families. But let's remember this. Nobody can do it better than the Lord has, right? This is the go-to manual for every family relationship. So let's take a look. Verse 18, for the wives. There's one verb, there's one instruction in verse number 18 that is God calls on wives to do something. We're not going to go to other verses and talk about everything else that's required of wives. But in this case, God's message is for the wives, their action is to submit. And in this case, it's submit to your own husbands. Now, that word submit, the Greek word behind it is used a number of times in the New Testament. Let's think about some other verses and see if we can get a feel for what that idea involves here, to submit. That's the same word that's used in Romans 13 and verse 1, where the Bible says, let every soul be subject unto the powers that be. In other words, let every citizen be in subjection to civil government. So whatever is expected of citizens in terms of their responsibility to civil government, that submission, that's the idea here in wives dealing with their husbands. In Titus chapter 2 and verse number 9, the instruction there is for bondservants. And the instruction for bondservants in Titus 2 and verse 9, the reading in English is for those servants to be obedient to their masters. That's what that means here in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 18. In Titus chapter 2 and verse 5, the older women are to teach the younger women to be obedient to their husbands. That's the same word here. We're not talking about who's the better person. It's not a question of character. It's not a question of quality, of effort. It's a matter of God's arrangement for the home. And in order for a family to be the best it can be, the wife in that home is to be in submission to her husband, not someone else's husband. And the instruction given here in verse 18 is, as it is fit in the Lord. In other words, it's proper in God's sight. This is the proper arrangement. In some cases, a couple will get married and the plan is for them on a temporary basis to live with either the parents of the new wife or the parents of the new husband. And they're taking this approach as a temporary approach, and there may be a number of factors involved. Well, if that's the case, everybody involved, the dad and the mom who live in the home and this new couple, everybody needs to understand that that dad or that dad-in-law, he's not the head of his daughter or daughter-in-law. That's not the arrangement. Her head is her husband. And that's the divine plan, and it ought to be the practice in every home. Now, she may ask daddy for advice or daddy-in-law for advice, depending on the home in which they live. But the one to whom she's being submission to is her husband. And it goes without saying, husbands, I'm going to throw it in just so you don't get this too much in the ribs tonight. A husband ought to conduct himself in such a way that his wife is so crazy about him and respects him so much that she gladly submits herself to him. Okay, so brief instruction for wives. Now then, husbands, two instructions in verse 19 we find for husbands. Number one is the love, and number two, don't be bitter. You know, there are different words that the Greeks had for the concept of love. We have love. We love our puppy. We love our pizza. We love our whatever it is. But the Greeks had different words. And so there's the word that we sometimes think of as brotherly love, the affectionate friend love. And then there's agape. Here's the verb form of agape, which is the highest form of love, which wants what's best for someone else. And so the appeal is for husbands to love their wife in such a manner that they want what is best for their wives. Now, don't we as husbands have a model to imitate in that regard? Yeah, we'll bring in here, okay? We'll bring in Ephesians 5 and verse 25. Husbands, love your wives as, in the same manner, as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, Ephesians 5:25. So there's the standard. For husbands, not simply say, well, I loved her, let me just check. No, it's not a thing where you check it off your list and move on to something else. That's an ongoing process. How would we describe the love Jesus had for the church? Sacrificial, unconditional, selfless, pure? Well, that's the kind of love that God wants husbands to have for their wives. Okay? Now, there's a second aspect of the interaction here, relationship, in verse 19, and it's really interesting. The instruction is, don't be bitter against your wives. And you think, well, why would a husband ever be bitter? Well, what could there have been going on in the first century in families that could ever cause a husband to be bitter against his wife? It's not saying the wife's at fault. You know, sometimes a person can be bitter against somebody else and that second person hasn't done anything wrong, right? So we would simply throw out the ideas, husband, if your wife is more skilled at doing something than you, if she does something in life and she's just better at it, maybe she's better in terms of athletics, maybe she's better in singing, maybe she's better in whatever it is, don't let that recognition cause you to be bitter against her. You know, there are some cases in history, and I think maybe you might can think of one in the Bible, where the wife, at least for a period of time, was unable to bear children. And there have been cases where unthoughtful and ignorant husbands have become upset with their wife because she's unable to bear children. If she's not able to bear children, why would you be bitter with her? Well, that's not right. Or maybe we could envision a case where a wife, in some fashion, did something, said something in the presence of her husband and others that embarrassed him. And she's apologized. She's told the people involved, said, look, I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry. I was wrong. And she apologized. Well, look, husband, move on. She's apologized. She's shown the courage to say she was wrong. She's shown the courage to tell others, move on. Don't be bitter against her. Because, you know, bitterness, it just eats at the peace inside of a family. So there's your instruction. Again, we're not going to run every place, but wives and husbands. Now then, children. Do we have any? Well, I know we all have parents. But do we have any children Do we have any children who are still in that relationship where they're still under the what? The authority of their parents? Well, we got some. You say, well, preacher, why are you picking on us? Folks, we're just going through the text. Not picking on anybody. But the Holy Spirit singled out this group of people. And so here's something for children to do. What's your verb of action in verse number 20? Children are to obey. Okay? Obey their parents. Now, The word obey here is a little bit different word in the Greek than what we read in verse 18 about the wife submitting. The word in the Greek comes over and is translated into English by Mr. Thayer as to hearken. And he said it's used like in a case where you hear somebody at the door and somebody knocking at the door, you go to see who's there. It's like somebody calling you and you come and say, well, what is it you want? And so that's the attitude that children are to have toward their parents. Okay? I'm at your beck and call. You have a need for me to do something? Well, here I am, okay? And so the instruction is, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. The last part of that verse makes it plain, this is not Paul riding off the top of his head. This is not, we've gone out into the community and surveyed the people in our community, and here's what we found. Here's what people would like to see. In fact, that's not it at all. But the message is this. What? Children obeying parents is well-pleasing to the Lord. It certainly reminds us of a parallel verse over in Ephesians 6 and verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. It's proper. It's appropriate. It's the right course of action for children to obey their parents. Mom and Dad didn't come up with that rule. God did. And it applies in every culture, in every family. That's the way God wants it to be. It should not be the children who are running the home, so to speak, but it ought to be the parents who are running the home. And so, do I really need to explain those words there in verse 19? In all things? In all matters? What is there about that needs an explanation? Someone said, well, there might be exceptions. Well, there could be exceptions, but let's deal with the rule. Here's the principle. And this, you know, every society is made up of families. The basic unit of every society is the home or family. And so when this is lacking in the home, that's going to leak over into other aspects of society. Now, parents may, in some cases, be part of the issue of their children not obeying the parents. The old instruction from Proverbs 29 and verse 15 is that the rod and reproof or rebuke, I think the New King James says, the double R, the rod and the rebuke, they bring about wisdom. But a son or a child left to himself, that brings his mother to shame. And so that's the divine arrangement. That's the way it's supposed to be. Now, let's move on, number 21, to fathers. What an interesting instruction. Fathers, provoke not your children. And then in my Bible it has in italics, provoke not your children to anger. Now what does that mean when it's in italics? It means in the original writing of the text, those words to anger were not in the text. But the translators have supplied those words because they feel like they're implied, or by adding them, it makes it read a little bit more smooth. Now, I've forgorgotten on the New King James. Does it have them in italics, Les? Do you have the same reading in the New King James? Or does it just have, provoke not your children? Is it to anger, or is it just not in italics? Okay, so somebody said, well, that's interesting, though. For dads not to provoke their children. We know in Ephesians 6, in that parallel passage in Ephesians 6:4, you've got this instruction, probably sounds more familiar. Fathers, provoke not your children unto wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So the appeal to dads is, don't provoke your children. And in the bottom part, or the latter part of verse 21 is, lest they be discouraged. Just like adults, children of various ages, young children, elementary school age, middle school age, high school age, college age, they can become discouraged. And as dads, and we would, you know, say as moms, we don't want to add to their discouragement. As they're going through life and changes and going on in life, it's hard enough with all the ups and downs and changes and new experiences to, you know, to be happy. We don't want to add to their discouragement. Now, let's step back for a minute and think about this word or idea of provoking children. Somebody says, well, I guess that means parents should never do anything to make their children unhappy. That's not correct. That's not what it means. It doesn't mean that parents are required to ask their children, honey, would this make you happy or upset? If this would upset you, I'll never, ever do it. That's not the arrangement at all. That's not the thought. Well, what might be, let's think about some scenarios, some practical application where a dad might provoke his children to anger and they just get totally frustrated and bummed out. Now, there may be some cases in life where parents are going to, even if I may use the word force, maybe not physically, but force their children to do some things those children don't want to do. That child may say, I don't want to ever, ever, ever clean up my room again. Well, I guess you don't want to eat again. When you decide you're hungry enough, you'll clean up your room. Okay? I don't think I'm ever, ever going to brush my teeth again. I guess you don't want to eat again. You find yourself hungry enough, I guess you'll brush it. So just because a child responds with that I'm not happy face or that I'm not happy attitude, it doesn't mean that the parents are provoking. If the parents establish rules and limitations, the parents are not provoking. Well, what might be some situations where a dad or parents are provoking children to wrath or anger? Well, if they go the Jacob, I love Joseph more than my any other son's route, you could see how that would be a disaster, right? When parents show affection for, preference for one child over the other children, well, how do you expect the other children to respond? They may not sell that brother or sister into slavery like the 10 older brothers of Joseph did, but they're not going to be happy campers, and dad and moms who do that, they have a part in provoking those children. Or perhaps you've known of cases where a parent or parents, perhaps not intentionally, but the way it comes across and what they say and do, it sure makes that other child think, well, they're comparing children, saying, look, why can't you be more like your sister? She never got in trouble. She never got any C's. Why can't you be more like her? And guess what that does? That makes their blood boil. You're provoking them to anger. Or you ask children, hey, look, here's something that we're thinking about doing, and we want to get your input on. The mom and dad are going to make the final decision, but we want your input. And when the children give their input, the mom and dad just like they put their hands over, and the kids, what's the point? What's the point of even telling you what we think when you never, ever, ever listen? Well, you could understand how those approaches would provoke children to anger and completely be disheartened. And so, you know, that's pretty practical in every generation. Now, we got two more relationships. Well, it's one relationship, just as we have the wife. And so I guess when you break it down, I talked about six sets of instructions. You might really think about it, three sets of instructions. You got the marriage relationship, 18 and 19, wives and husbands. You've got the parents and children relationship, 20 and 21. And then beginning in verse 22 and going through chapter 4 and verse 1, you've got the servant and master relationship. So let's take a look. What's the verb of action in verse 22 when it comes to what servants are supposed to do? Answer, obey their masters. Now, just out of interest, the Greek word behind that word obey in verse number 22, it's the same word in verse 20 for children. So whatever children are to do in their relationship with their parents, that's what the servants are to do in their relationship with their masters. And that is not with eye service as men pleasers. I think the idea is You don't simply be loyal and faithful when somebody's looking over your shoulder. But you be loyal and faithful at all time. And the thought there in verse 22 and 23, you do it with the Spirit as if you were doing it to the Lord. Verse 23 is a great principle that applies in a number of aspects in life. Whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. It certainly sounds like Ecclesiastes 9 and verse 10. Whatsoever your hand finds to do, do it with your mind. Now, today, we don't have this much of this relationship in the world. What we have that would be similar to it, not exactly the same, what we would have that would be similar is an employer and employee relationship. And if you and I hire on someplace, it's with the understanding if we hire on and we are the employees, then we're not the ones who establish the guidelines for how things go. Now, if they ask us and give us input, that's another question. But if something's going on at work, then my responsibility is to be in submission to those who are in higher authority above me. And if I find that I just can't go on doing that, then it may be time for me to seek employment at another place. But there's that relationship again of being in submission. Verse 24, knowing that you shall receive the reward of the inheritance for you serve the Lord Christ. Well, which simply would indicate this. In the first century, throughout the Roman Empire, there were tens and tens of millions of bondservants. And so as the gospel spread throughout the Roman Empire, it's not surprising that a number of bondservants learned about the gospel. And the role of bondservants and their responsibility, well, let's just kind of think out loud. It's mentioned in the book of 1 Corinthians. It's mentioned in Ephesians. It's mentioned in Colossians. It's mentioned in Philemon. It's mentioned in 1 Timothy. It's mentioned in Titus. It's mentioned in, something else, sure, 1 Peter. So there are a lot of instructions in the New Testament. But what you see here, I think, in verse 24 is, look, part of your serving the Lord is being the best servant that you can be. And for us today, part of us serving the Lord is being the best employee that we can be. Now, on the other side of that, chapter 4 and verse 1, the masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal. Or the New King James says, just and fair. And we might step back and ask the question, isn't that the way we like to be treated? When we're dealing with individuals and they have expectations of us or we have expectations of them, don't we like to be treated fairly? And so that's the instruction here for those masters. And then there's this, what we might call reminder, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. You know what that sounds like? In 1 Peter chapter 5, the first three verses are instruction for elders, okay? You have the oversight of the flock, and you're to shepherd or feed the flock. And then in verse 4 of 1 Peter chapter 5, it talks about we and you, elders, you have a chief shepherd. A reminder to the elders, yes, you serve as shepherds of a local flock, but you're not the top shepherd. And here's a reminder to masters, yes, you have that relationship on earth, but you're responsible to the master in heaven. Part of serving the Lord is how we interact with other people. And these are instructions that God gave in the first century that are eternal to apply throughout all of man's existence on earth. If we want our families to be the best they can be, then we need to pay attention to these simple instructions that God has given. If we want our relationships with other people to be the best they can be, we need to pay attention to what God has to say. Now we're going to take two more lessons, God willing, to look at some closing matters. God willing, next week, we're going to look at a section of chapter 4 that deals with prayer and communication. And then in our last lesson, lesson number 10, we're going to look at the thought of you mean something to the God of heaven. Tonight we've not talked about what's required in order to become a member of God's family. But by the grace of God, through the blood of Jesus, it's possible to hear the gospel, believe it, obey it, and be baptized into the Christ for the remission of sins, and God adds those people to His church. If you've never done that, why not tonight? Maybe here's a child of God and you need the prayers of the saints. It's God's invitation. Would you come as you stand and we sing?
Hear the sweet voice of Jesus say, come unto me, I am the way. Hearken the loving call, obey. Come for me, loves you so. Only a step, only a step. Come for me, bled for you and died. He's the same loving Savior yet. Jesus the crucified. Casting your heavy burden down, come to the cross, the world may frown. Yet he shall wear a glorious crown when he makes up his own. Only a step, only a step. Come for me, bled for you and I. He's the same loving Savior yet. Jesus the crucified. Open for you the pearly gate. Loved ones for you, now watch and wait. Terrible thoughts to cry too late. Jesus, I come to thee.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we offer our prayer of thanks for this bread, which represents Christ's body that was nailed on the cross. As we partake of it, we pray that we do it in a pleasing way. In Christ's name, amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we also offer our prayer of thanks for this cup, this fruit of the vine, which represents Christ's blood that was spilled on our behalf, as we reflect on that, we pray that we do it in a pleasing way. In Christ's name, amen. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for all that we receive from Thee. We know that all that we need to sustain life comes from Thee. As we return a portion, we pray that we do it in a pleasing way and with a cheerful heart. In Christ's name, amen.
To start out the week with the last song of number 305. 305.
Earthly wealth and fame may never come to me, and a palace fair here mine may never be.
Let us pray, Heavenly Father. We ask for all the many blessings that you give us. We're so thankful for them. We're thankful for your Son, Jesus Christ, came to this earth, spread your word, and gave himself for remission of our sins. Heavenly Father, we ask a prayer for this congregation. We pray all things we do right in thy sight. And we're thankful for the lessons we've heard today. Heavenly Father, we pray for those we have that are shut in, unable to attend. We pray for those that mentioned earlier that's going to have procedures this week, Teresa Tatum, and we pray for Madeline McNabb, pray for Shane Shirley, and pray for Danny Brown and Dale Clark, and their operations go well. Heavenly Father, we pray for our military and first responders, watch over and keep them safe, and we pray you watch over us, bring us back, and keep us safe. In Christ's name we pray, amen.